Good evening and welcome to this evening's meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California. You can find the club on the internet at thecommonwealthclub.org. Tonight's program is presented in partnership with the Commonwealth Club's Grown-Ups Forum. I'm Victoria Colliver, your moderator for tonight's program. I'm a healthcare reporter for the San Francisco Chronicle and a blogger for ChronRx, the San Francisco Chronicle's blog on health, medicine, and wellness. You can read me online at sfgate.com. It's now my pleasure to introduce our very special guest, Dr. Walter Bortz II. Dr. Walter Bortz is a clinical associate professor, soon to be full professor, at Stanford School of Medicine, an authority on aging, veteran of 41 marathons, and is still just a couple decades short of 100. At the tender age of 81, he has finished his seventh book, Next Medicine, The Science and Civics of Health, in which he looks at the American healthcare system as a patient, discusses its symptoms, and prescribes various treatments. Rather than going into it further, let's hear the diagnosis from the doctor himself. What's wrong with the patient, and is there any hope for a cure? I introduce Dr. Bortz.
Thank you very much, and appreciate everyone's being here, but particularly appreciate the hosting of the Commonwealth Club, which I love. I love the Commonwealth Club. I think it's maybe my sixth or seventh opportunity at this podium. I've given a number of talks at outlying Commonwealth Clubs. And I guess the reason I love it so much is you're all so smart. Lots of times people are kind of glazed over, but when I'm at the Commonwealth Club, you really feel you're being engaged. So thank you, George, and everybody at the Commonwealth Club. My occasion this evening is to display my latest book. I've written six previous books on four on aging and two on diabetes, but all of those were just rehearsals for this book. This is my magnum opus. I've been waiting for this. I'm a 1955 graduate from the University of Pennsylvania School of Medicine. My father was president of the AMA. My wife is a daughter of a GP in Boston who took her tonsils out on the kitchen table. We are the parents of Walter Bortz, a doctor, a GP up in Ukiah, so we're very thickly embraced by my field of medicine. But I'm very disturbed by it. And in contemplating writing this book, Next Medicine, it brought back all sorts of encounters that were uncertain and unsavory, but important to display. Because in my judgment, medicine's sick. I wrote an op-ed for the New York Times two or three days ago called Healing the American Healthcare System. And that came from a nice patient opportunity who gave me $5,000 to do with as I wished. And I said, what I'm going to do is send my book to every senator. And so Victor Fuchs, who some of you may know, an old friend of mine, probably the leading medical economist of America, he's down at Stanford, he said, don't do that. He said, they'll junk it at the front door. So call up my friend Judy Jones, and I'd never heard of Judy, but Judy apparently is a health policy lady at George Washington. And it's my understanding that all the congressional staffers find their way to Judy's antechamber to get the laid down on the latest legislation. So I called Judy up, and she could not have been more obliging and cordial, and I sent her a copy of the book. But her advice was, don't send the book because Congress is just like this right now. She said it's just mayhem back there. Said what you should do is write an op-ed for the New York Times, which I submitted two or three days ago, off into the ether, uncertain whether anybody ever picks it up. But you're here and I'm here, and I want to give you a microsecond of what my book is about because I think it's a very important book. That's not just the author speaking. It's someone who has now received two wonderful reviews. One is in Science magazine, and the other one is in JAMA. And I met with the writer from Boston School of Harvard School of Public Health when we were in Boston recently, and they're fabulous reviews, and my wife Ruthann has copies of them out there. The one negative, if it is a negative, was one of them called me idealistic. And so if I'm idealistic, I stand accused and guilty because I want to be there. And I said, it reminds me of the wonderful conversation between Wilberforce and Huxley. Huxley was known as Darwin's bulldog, and so descent of mankind was Darwin's big book, Selection, Natural Selection. And a year or so afterwards, Wilberforce, the Archbishop of Oxford, arranged the debate with Huxley and himself. And they were debating this, and Wilberforce turns to Huxley in the middle of this and says, tell me, Professor, on which side of your family were you descended from a monkey? And so Huxley brings back and he says, I would rather be descended from a monkey than be the descendant of a cleric who obscures the truth. Whoa. I said, bravo. I said, so if I am an idealist, if I'm wishful in this book, I stand accused of that because it's really bad. So my profession has lost its dignity. It's lost its sense. It's idealism. It's no longer a profession, it's a business. So profit becomes the ruling element, and my diagnosis of my symptoms is a collision of biology and capitalism. Now, our biology is newly revealed to us by my other field of geriatrics. We know now how long we can live, and we know what the shaping forces that allow us to live that long. We know what the extent and content of the human existence. So we know the determinants of health. And we know how long we can live. I say 100 is your birthright. Do you know on the opposite side of your birth certificate there's an expiration date? It's 100 years from your birth date. So we now know our biology well enough that 100 is what you're given if you don't mess it up. Now, that's terrific. Now, things happen along the way, and I wrote a paper in the American Journal of Public Health called The Determinants of Health, and very quickly summarized, it's like a car. Design, accidents, maintenance, and age. Same for us. If you're a bad seed, you ain't going to do so good. But very, very few of the ailments of mankind are genetic. And the way you know that is to go to the twins of the world and look at whether they die simultaneously of the same disease. And we did that at the Institute of Medicine in Washington. And twins die something like 6.7 years apart, rarely of the same condition. Non-identical twins die 7.3 years apart. Same birth date, not related people die 8.2. So you turn it by a statistician, it turns out that genes are about 15%. Of the determinants of longevity. And I love that because I'm a student of the Serenity Prayer, change what you can, accept what you must. So I want things to be important that you can do something about. So that's design. What about accidents? Accidents are things that happen to us intercurrently through life. Lightning, infections, malignancies, wars, starvation. Things have happened, and the church has exploited accidents because the church, until Pasteur, was the therapist of mankind. Sin was a bad cause of cholera and diphtheria and small. And Pasteur comes along in 1865 and said, no, it ain't sin, it's a bug. So Pasteur birthed modern medicine. From then on, it became a science, became something identifiable, coherent, and approachable. So those are accidents. My big thing has been maintenance. Again, like a car, fuel and RPMs. You got to use the right amount and the good fuel in the car, and you have to know the right amount of RPMs. Not too many, which is stress, and not too few, which is disuse. And that's been my particular interest. And I've written extensively on disuse because disuse as we age, is a 30-year age offset. Restated, a fit person of 70 is as an unfit person of 40. Very strong biologic demonstrations of that. So you want to be able to differentiate the things you can change, disuse and stress, from those things you can't, which is the drops of sand in the hourglass. Can't do nothing about aging. Aging is entropy. It's the second law of thermodynamics. And as we age, we generate free radicals, which are the metabolic ash, trash of metabolism. And they get in and mess up our elasticity and our arteries and our brains. So we understand what aging is. Leonard Hayflick is one of my good friends, the Hayflick phenomenon. He said, aging is now a done thing. We know what it is. There's a ribbon on it. We don't need any more science to explain. It's the second law of thermodynamics. Everything in the universe ages. We age. Chevys age. Canyons age. And everything's going this way. But there's an offset of being fit. So my wife and I are marathon runners. I learned it when I was 40, when my dad died. I was depressed. Three good things happened when I started to run marathons, because I knew that exercise is a fabulous treatment for depression. The second good thing that happened when my dad died, we moved to California, and we love California. It's so much better than Bryn Mawr in its best days. And the third good thing, I became a geriatrician, because I came to Stanford, and they said, ooh, what are these little obscure articles you wrote with your dad? You are now our designated geriatrician. So by appointment, I became a geriatrician with three good things happening. One is I got to take care of thousands of Palo Altans as they were sliding down the battle of their lifeline. I had an extraordinary personal experience. The second, I learned about aging for myself. I learned about death for myself. I'm not afraid of death at all, because I've got it well rationalized. But the big thing is, aging teaches you about life. I talked at the American College of Physicians in Philadelphia and say, aging geriatrics is the doorway to next medicine. Why? Because aging is not a disease. You can't cure it. So if my profession of medicine is in the repair business, we have two tools in our black bag. We have surgery, and we have pharmacy. That's what's in the medicine's black bag, because we can charge you for it. But what if is coming along the pike? Aging and diabetes are not subjected to pills or surgery. So I talked at Stanford Grand Rounds last week, and my topic was square peg, round hole. $2.7 trillion we spend in America on health care, which isn't health care, it's disease care, because we want to send you a bill. So my diagnosis is the collision of biology learned largely from the studies on aging and capitalism. We're all capitalists. I'm a capitalist. I believe in capitalism. It's the best social construct we have to make the gears of society work. But it's selling the wrong product. Our capitalism sells disease. We want you to bleed, or we want you to have a spot that we don't know, and that will generate x-ray after x-ray after x-ray. So whereas medicine is invested in the disease business, the repair business, Stanford, where I love my life there, I'm very devoted to Stanford, it's a repair shop. You go there to get fixed. Why? Because we can send you a bill for that. Back when my dad was a doctor in downtown Philadelphia, his patients used to pay him by barter. And we have in our families three oil paintings of a down on his luck Russian painter, Gektov, that paid dad by oil paintings. Well, can you imagine me going into the accounting office at Stanford Hospital and say, by the way, I just had my knee scoped. Here's my payment for it. So the whole system of medicine is in error now. One of my favorite references is Kuhn's book, The Structure of Scientific Revolution. He said, in order for there to be revolution, there are two prerequisites. One, there must be an agreement that things are bad. I think everybody says things are bad now. But more importantly, there must be a replacement paradigm, is his great word, a replacement paradigm. So back to the colonists. In 1775, there was an agreement. Pennsylvania, New York, and Virginia sat in Philadelphia and put their name on a parchment. We hereby declare. A few years later, there had to be a replacement paradigm. So once again in Philadelphia in 1775, the Constitutional Convention wrote a new paradigm, and the new paradigm was democracy instead of monarchy. So our colonists set the motif for what one does to have a revolution. I think medicine now needs a revolution. We need a new paradigm. The new paradigm is health. The new paradigm is prevention, because now we know enough to prevent 95% of the illnesses out there. But there's no money in it. So we must change the entire superstructure of our societal. And maybe the Commonwealth Club gets a certain royalty, George, because I describe in my book something called common health. The common health. Not doctors, not hospitals, not pharmacy, schools and trails and environment. Common health. That's what we need. There's a wonderful paper written by Steve Schroeder, who was out here at UCSF, on determinants of health. And he said, medical care is about 10% of the total bargain. It's common health. It's how it all merges in. So I want Stanford, my home body, to stop being a tech shop. Everybody's got their own lab. Everybody's got their own startup, because they're dominated by the genes. The genes are all bogus. They're this important. It ain't have the genes, it's what you do with the genes. I'm talking to the United Health Company in Minneapolis on Friday. I want them to have a health policy that we, Stanford, can do a gene analysis and show how fit you are and charge you on that. This year, next year, 10 years from now. And if you're on an ascending curve, we'll charge you less and less and less. Because a great paper written by Steve Blair said, physical fitness and all-cause mortality. So when you get to my age, 70, 80, the difference between fit people and unfit people is something like tenfold. Now that's got to have major dollar implications. It's got to have major science. So I'm trying to sell this to United Health, who insure 60 million people. So my book is a statement of all of these things. It's some basic science in there. I was saying I was hoping my book could be for health what Silent Spring was for the environment. Rachel Carson lit us up, to a lesser extent, Al Gore. But I would like my book to be the clarion call. Let's go to health. Why not health? It makes sense. We all agree. We are compacted because of industrial complications. So I welcome you to join me in reading my book. My wife would be happy to interest you in the back. She's a little shrimpy girl. She took her running shoes off to come to the party tonight. But we're both going to run the San Francisco Marathon on the 31st of July. So I think there's still some spots open in that. So welcome. Thanks for your attention.
Thank you, Dr. Bortz. You're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program. We're talking with Dr. Walter Bortz, Stanford Medical Professor and author of Next Medicine, about the defects of the American healthcare system and why it places profit before human well-being. Dr. Bortz, your book comes at a great time. The federal health law is a major topic of debate, and provisions are being rolled out. There's a lot of discussion over Medicare, and the voucher system, but let's start with Obama's health law, and this leads into one of the audience questions. Basically, you know, the Obama's health law will ultimately require most Americans to obtain private health insurance and roll millions more people into the Medicaid program for the poor. Are we on the right track here? Should insurance companies exist at all, as one audience member asks?
Well, thank you for that. And I think we are at a tipping point. Tipping points demand competence to address them adequately. Now, my read of the Obama health bill, it was a baby step. It addressed the uninsured predominantly. And to me, to think America as not having universal coverage is an outrage. I mean, we're very wealthy as a country, but we maldistribute the responsibility and our assets. So the first stage of the reform has been universal coverage, and I'm very much in favor of that. But the derivative question immediately is coverage of what? If you're meaning everybody's going to have payment for all their drugs and all the high-tech stuff, that's, again, it's pouring money down a black hole, because you could not possibly deliver all the benefits that everyone would wish, because people are healthier than they would wish you to be. Your illness is not my job. Your illness is your job. Every year I talk to the Stanford Business School, I give the first lecture. They say, what's this yobo doctor doing talking to us guys that are here to get rich? I said, what's the most important asset in your life? Health? There's no argument that health is your most important asset. Second question, who owns it? Does Walgreens own it? Does Stanford own it? Kaiser? No. So we're at the position right now of allowing one to have personal responsibility. I was on a CNN program at the studio up here in California, and I was beating my chest, as I am for you. And the hostess was in New York, and she held the microphone. What do you think of what the doctor just said? I don't believe anything he said. These doctors all think they're smart. Said, I lie down every time I feel like taking a walk. I love fat, and she was huge. So she just punctured this pompous professor from Stanford, and so they say to me, Dr. Bortz, what do you say to that? And I say, well, blah, 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 blah. What I say to it is, an American, I respect the right of anybody to say anything once, but I immediately identify that rights come from responsibility, and when you're not responsible, you forfeit the right. Station break, dead air. Coming back on, I became very proud of that. Because rights come from responsibility, and we're at the juncture of coming from everybody being cared for on the public dole to saying, no, no, you got to pay for your irresponsibility. Now, that depends on knowledge. Ben Franklin said, how can you hold a newborn responsible? You can't. But you can hold her responsible, because now we know she's going to, diabetes is $11,000 per person per year. There are 30 million Americans with diabetes, all preventable. So who should pay that bill? Should we all share in that? Or is there not a calling in of the call right now? So I'm enthusiastic about Mr. Obama. I love his messaging, and I'm very hopeful of 2012, and I really want him to take off then. I want him to finish the rest of the job. We've done universal coverage now. Now I want to cover health. I want there to be incentives to be healthy. I think we spend $2.8 trillion a year on healthcare. Take half of it and put it in education. Health illiteracy is my goal. Stanford University should be teaching health, not advanced cardiac imaging. How do you do that? Well, different job than advanced. So, and a ram around the corner answer to your question.
Okay. Arizona says it's going to charge Medicaid recipients $50 a year if they smoke or are obese. Is that a step in the right direction, do you think?
Do you hear the question? States and elsewhere are starting to charge people for behavior. I know that Singapore, being a tiny little country, will not promote their kids if their BMIs go up. What? Can you imagine me going to the Palo Alto School Board and say, we're not going to promote your kid if they don't lose weight? But Singapore has no financial reserves. They can't have half of our school, Hispanic school kids now will become diabetic. Half of them. A third of school kids will become diabetic. as they are now constituted. Stanford has no input to that, except, you know what we are doing at Stanford now? Bariatric surgery, which just sits right here in my craw. To think that the answer to obesity is to operate on your belly and shut it closed. Why do we do that at Stanford? It's a profit center. It's a disgrace. To me, it's obscene. In my lecture at Grand Rounds, operating on a fat kid to sew their stomach shut is like amputating the fingers of a smoker. Is that a little rough? But it's analogous. So why do we turn to technology to solve a behavioral issue? Because there's money in it.
And another audience member points out, but how do we provide the incentives for physicians to focus on healthy lifestyle?
How do we incent? Well, my model is Kaiser. I lectured at Kaiser. I know Halverson, the head. And the Thrive is correct. We all ought to thrive. We ought to do what the messaging is. The trouble is, Kaiser is immature. They don't do it themselves. I suggested that in order to be a Kaiser employee, they had to be obese. Because every nurse, every receptionist has a BMI that's off the top of the scale. So if that's, why doesn't Kaiser do it themselves? How would you imagine a physician who smokes could get their patient to stop smoking? Couldn't. So we need to internalize health. We have to live it. We have to. One of my heroes at Stanford is Albert Bandura. Albert Bandura is the most cited psychologist in the world, and his whole thing is self-efficacy. Self-efficacy is one of these very highfalutin, abstruse terms, but it's the very core of what health is. Self-efficacy means owning yourself, responsible to oneself. And we are so intrinsically healthy if we listen to the cues from our own Mother Nature. So we need Bandura to come in and teach all of us how to be self-efficacious, which is small steps of mastery, peer examples, rewards. I'm a capitalist. I want to pay you to be healthy. This thing I'm going to put to the United Health on Friday. I really hope that works out.
One of my frustrations as a healthcare reporter is that in the midst of this healthcare crisis, during which premiums are spiraling out of control, a lot of people are making a lot of money. And it's pharmaceutical companies, as you point out in your book, and medical equipment manufacturers, but a lot of providers as well. We're looking at specialists, large medical groups, major hospital networkers, and I'm assuming to save money, some people may have to make less money. But how do you view the role of the provider in the whole money-making mechanism? Are they as responsible, less responsible?
If you're not part of the solution, you're part of the problem. So everybody's part of the problem. I've had the good fortune of having been to Cuba twice, and I go down there on a philanthropic errand for a major philanthropist here, and I said, I come to Cuba to see what we can do for you. I come home from Cuba and say, what can you do for us? Because their longevity is equal to America's, and I think they spend $3 per person per year on health care costs. But every corner has a nurse practitioner. There are no scanners there. There are no gene laboratories. But it's behavior. 90% of human illness is behavior. Within my prevention chapter, I have a whole chapter in my book on prevention. I cite Walter Willett. Walter Willett is probably the biggest voice on prevention. He said 90% of cancer is preventable. However, the domos in the cancer field at the National Cancer Institute, the American Cancers, they're all therapists. They're all surgeons, radiologists, or chemotherapy. So we want to treat you after the fact, but how about putting half of the, how much are we spending? $50 billion a year on cancer. How about take half of that to prevention? Ooh, that's a novel idea. But New York has done well. And our new head of, CDC was the head of the public health department, and he had this huge campaign on smoking in New York. And I think there's something like 2 million fewer smokers in New York now. So it can be done when there's a will, when there's a participation, when there's a common health approach. What was the question?
Here's an interesting question. You mentioned genes, accidents, and aging as factors in one's health and longevity. But what about spirituality? Might this be a factor as well? Although medical science can't fully or perhaps adequately its effects, should it be dismissed? Is what the
thank you. That's a wonderfully probing and appropriate question. I have now gotten very involved in a group at Harvard, headed by my friend Eddie Phillips, and Harvard has started the Institute for Lifestyle Medicine. What? Harvard imprint on the Institute for? I could no more get that through at Stanford because everybody's got shares in A, B, C, the president on down. They're all industrialists. So what about lifestyle? Fabulous stuff, and it totally defers to Herb Benson. Anybody know Herb Benson? He's a big Harvard psychiatrist about helplessness and hopelessness and owning your health. Herb is a big player in it. So we need a total immersion in the spiritual thing. And I have to take this opportunity to tell you my recent encounter with a book. The book was written by Irv Yalom, one of our major psychiatrists on the peninsula, and Irv wrote a book called Staring at the Sun. And in it, he develops this imagery that is, to me, so profound and so personally helpful, Staring at the Sun by Irving Yalom. He says, when we die, there can be no dispute that our corporate ballast, our calcium and magnesium and carbon, goes off into the cosmic dust whence we arose. So our bodies are dust. Soon as we exhale, we go to dust. Now, none of us like the idea of oblivion. A world without me in it, that's not possible. So how do I participate in this world if I'm dust? He said, the way you participate in it is as ripples. Love it. Exactly right. We are the residual of ripples. We are the generator of ripples. And what is eternal are the ripples that we cause to happen because of our existence. And I just love that. It brings my whole philosophy and science to a point. It's a garnering of energies. So I think that comes pretty close to a religion. And I have talked to people who, I am not very religious. As a matter of fact, I'm probably at the other extreme, but I am religious. If you'll allow me to say that primal energy is kind of my God, and think that insofar as we can internalize that selflessly, generously, then we are ourselves improved.
Dr. Bortz, in your books, you lay out the symptoms of a sick patient, which the patient you call current medicine. And one of the areas you focus on is health inequities. I find it interesting, the disparities between life expectancies and disease rate, between racial and economic divides. I was interested in a passage in which you discussed a neighborhood assessment exercise. You participated with Stanford medical students and different ethnic groups in East Palo Alto, and you had different priorities. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Oh, thank you. That was an exciting time. I have been the head of every possible aging congregation in the Palo Alto area, including the East Palo Alto Senior Center. And that's a black gang. And I was the only white person on the board. And I loved it. We built the senior center over there. And as part of that, I recruited a bunch of Stanford medical students to go into East Palo Alto and by ethnic group, young and old, say, what are your perceived health needs? Do you need a nurse practitioner? Do you need a pharmacy? What do you need? And the students did this. Pacific Islanders, Mexicans, Caucasians, and blacks. And we got these results back. And the point that I bring out in the book was the results from the black community. Their number one perceived health care need was pit bull control. What? I mean, I could have labored there for months and that would have never showed up on my... So pit, that's what you think is your major... We can't take a walk because we're scared. So I said, what the hell do I do with this piece of information? So I call Roz Lasker up. Roz is a big health policy lady. I said, Roz, what do I do with this information? She says, you do it. That's what they think is their need. So what do? We get the cops and the animal control people and go in there and do pit bull control. So that's what I kind of mean by common health. If by virtue of their perception and having an ear that was sensitive and reactive to it, that's what Stanford Medical Center should be doing. They should have these antennas out there. What do you need? Not what we think you need, but what do you think we need?
You're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program. We're talking with Dr. Walter Bortz, author of Next Medicine and Stanford Medical Professor. The book is about the defects of the American healthcare system and why it places profit before human well-being. Here's a very specific question from an audience member who is familiar with reversed aging and mitochondrial function affecting memory. This is done in rodents. And this audience member wants to know if you foresee a future in this post, this reverse aging techniques.
Well, the age reversal is exercise. Fitness is a 30-year, and it's down at mitochondrial level. So it is down at the very basic science. We know how it is. It has to do with electron transfer. It's energy transfer. That's what exercise is. I'm running up a hill. Now, a friend of mine is Ken Cooper, who started the Cooper Institute. He said, Walter, you're running too much. You're generating all these free radicals. Right, Ken. When I'm running, I'm generating free radicals. And also, I'm using up my pulse beats, if you believe in that. Because when I run up a hill, my pulse is 150. But as I stand here before you tonight, my pulse is now about 45. So the net is gain. So as I'm running up a hill, I'm generating more free radicals. I am, yea, verily, generating more free radicals. But simultaneous with that, I'm upregulating my free radical enzyme. Scavenging enzymes so that the net byproduct, I, as a fit person, have fewer free radicals because I'm generating them, but I'm getting rid of them. So it is a common theme through thermodynamics, which is my field of insight into what aging is about, is that there are very profound truths. So fitness is a 30-year age offset for which there is no proxy. Last Monday, I did a thing. I came up to the Hyatt there at the Embarcadero because Andrew Weil was holding forth. I've been looking at Andrew Weil for decades. I walk in there, and the place is packed. $400 registration. The front of it are his disciples. We're Andrew Weil people, and it's all bogus. It's all vitamins with vanadium and all of this stuff. He sells vitamins. And Ken Cooper lost my support when he started huckstering vitamins. Vitamins are not the answer. Fitness is the answer. And there's no proxy for it. I wish Andrew Weil would have a running rather than whole by front of his books touting vitamins, which I think are not important.
In a related question, an audience member wants to know what the medical profession can do to give greater support to Michelle Obama's diet and education program.
I think Obama's brilliant, and he's got good advisors. I was disappointed that Daschle didn't make it, because I knew Daschle, I know him, but he ran afoul with some of his household help. So. But I think they're out there scanning what works. And one of my good friends is Alan Enthoven, who's the other major health economist. I talked to him an hour before I came in here tonight. And within this budget reconciliation, there are all sorts of doors opening for model experiments. Because it's not all rotten. I stand here in front of you kind of bashing my profession, and I don't feel comfortable doing that because every now and then it does good. And we need it, and I'm thrilled to have Stanford there. They just rescued our eldest daughter from something that could have been awful. So I want Stanford to thrive, but I want them to thrive by being a square peg for a square hole, not for putting their money into repair. One of my lectures, every Wednesday, I'm a slavish attendee at Medical Grand Rounds. It's our big show and tell. And we had an expert there on angiogenesis, angio blood vessels, genesis, new blood vessels, hot topic. Ooh, we were there breathless with anticipation, and this guy comes in here, and we're going to make new blood vessels. Ooh, that's good. And you need for this, you need a viral vector, and you need this gene fragment, and we're going to put this, and look there, see this guinea pig ear? See that little bit of blush there? That's new blood vessels. And I said, Doctor, you get the same thing with exercise. But he says there's no money in it. Aha. So now we can prevent 90% of our big killers. I'm recommending in my book a new medical specialty called preventive orthopedics. You've never heard that because that's an oxymoron. There's no such thing as, because all orthopedists are repair people, surgery and pills. But what if you don't get arthritis in the first place? Ooh, that's a novel idea. So we should be preventing arthritis because arthritis is a purely biomechanical condition. It's the rasping of the end of my femur with the top of my tibia. And when it gets overloaded or torqued, and we can measure that when you're 20, 30, 40, 50. So we need a medical specialty that goes through the vectors that prevent arthritis. Anybody got some startup money? We can do that.
Dr. Bortz, as a healthcare reporter, I find myself writing increasingly about BPA and other environmental factors that influence our health, things that we can't see or touch. Maybe they've been banned or been in our environment for a while. I know that you say genetics, bad luck play a role, but how much of a role do these environmental factors play, or do you have a feeling about that?
Well, again, I have no personal insight. I do cite Walter Willett at Harvard, he says most cancer is preventable. We don't know what there is, what we're breathing in. I'm not a subscriber to catastrophe theory. I think we are so marvelously made that we sop up most toxins and spit them out. But nonetheless, I think we could take half of the cancer budget and put it into prevention. Heart disease is surely preventable. We did a study at Stanford of some of my wife's 100-mile running buddies, and we did coronary arteriograms on them. We took them to the cath lab, and we put the catheter in their groin and ran it up to the root of their heart and shot the dye in these 100-mile runners. And I thought we'd kill this guy, because here was his artery like this. Holy God, we just killed him. No, it wasn't. His artery became where it was. The environment of a marathoner's artery is flow. So as there's flow going through an artery, it's stretching the artery. We become what we do. I was lecturing at Harvard a couple of years ago. A person in the audience said, hey, Doc, you'll like this one. If who you are is what you do, when you don't, you aren't. So we are very much a byproduct of the interface between our nature, our genes, and our nurture, which is the world. So if we're all going to walk or ride through airports, I mean, the thing that drives me particularly nuts are the horizontal escalators. And even worse are the beep, beep cars coming through. Do you notice all the people in those carts have a singular characteristic? Fill in the blank spot.
Here's a question that relates to mental illness, and particularly that in young people. This audience member would like to know what we can do, what the medical profession can do to help prevent, reduce the rates of suicide and improve mental illness or mental disease.
Well, my wife worked for suicide prevention a while, and their byline was suicide's is a permanent answer to a temporary problem. So certainly we need huge upgrade of our mental health capacities. And now, once again, I'm an enthusiast about fitness. Like, if you sit around and look at the wall all day, you tend to introspect, you tend to see the demons and the ogres that are out there. If you're running up a hill, it's very hard to be depressed when you're running up a hill. I was one of the first people that looked at the endorphin levels. I published it in the New England Journal of Medicine. When you're fit, your endorphins are way up. So is the answer Paxil or an antidepressant, or is it taking a run up a hill? So I'm sure I sound like a record with one tone on it about fitness, but I happen to believe that being fit is the answer to the prevention and therapy of almost all human ailments.
Dr. Bortz, I learned the term incidentaloma from your book, and I would like you to explain it a little bit. And I have a question about it, though, in terms of how, when something's discovered incidentally, it can add to the cost of the system, but it also can find a lump or something that's a disease entity early on.
We're talking about the term incidentaloma, and this is such a very piercing query to my wife and me now, because our daughter, Dana, our eldest kid, was having some minor belly ache, nothing much. And if I were her doctor, I'd give her some Maalox and send her home. But her doctor said, ooh, we've got to get a CAT scan, signature of our time. So they do a CAT scan and find she has a 3 centimeter cyst in her pancreas. So here am I, the big, fancy, slicker internist. I don't know anything about pancreatic cysts. But very fortunately, we got in the hands of Jeff at Stanford, who operated on Jobs, and he said, that's pre-malignant. Ooh, that changes the arguments pretty profoundly. So Jeffrey took her pancreas out 3 weeks, 4 weeks ago, which we should not have had it been on my watch. So an incidentaloma are things that are found artifactually. You go in for a sprained ankle and you get a head scan and you find you got a blush up here. Well, what's that blush? Well, we don't know, so we need another scan and another. So it's just like a cascade of one trouble leading to by necessity of getting an explanation for that. So an incidentaloma and incidentaloma are things that are just a shadow that would never have been recognized were it up. You have to wait till symptoms occur. One of the issues of aging is what I call our redundant function. Our redundant function describes how much health we've got. We've got 2 eyes, ears, lungs, kidneys, testicles. You only need one of these, which means you can start most of our function giving away 50% without apparent loss of function. I can see adequately one eye, hear well, run a marathon with one lung, so it means you give 50% away, no problem. Another 10% down to 40% and you're doing all right. Another 10%, and I'm short of breath, I'll see the doctor, another 10% and you're dead. So the standard clinical contact point between patient and physician is between 20 and 30% of starting allotment, which is one of the good news, bad news stories. It's great to have all this extra function. But when you start to have trouble, you ain't got much left. So all the money is spent down there between 20 and 30%. And if you're lucky, we're able to bounce it up into the functional range again. But we should celebrate health. Now we know the metrics of health. I was going to overstate my case about Richard Dawkins. I know Richard. He's been to my house. I've eaten. He wrote a book called Unweaving the Rainbow. And Unweaving the Rainbow is a topic of a poem that Keats wrote called Lamia. And what Keats took Newton to task for unweaving the rainbow. Keats said, why don't you let the rainbow be a rainbow? I don't want to know how many angstroms are on the left side and the right. Let it be a rainbow. But Dawkins took him on. He said, a rainbow does not lose any of its glory, its incandescence, by being measured. In fact, it achieves heightened exaltation by knowing what it is. It does not lose any of its beauty. I use the same analogy in my book for health, unweaving health. Now we know the parameters of health. Now we know how to measure health, like that thing I just gave you, how long we can live and how well we can live long.
Which country do you think has the best healthcare system and why?
A very profound, direct question, and I don't have a wonderful answer for that. Just as we were leaving Portola Valley on the way up here, I got out the World Health Report, put out by the World Health Organization every 10 years, and I know 2010, it's just up. I was just trying to cram for this meeting by looking at it, and I will as soon as I get home. But if you go back to the 2000 World Health Report, America's 38th in the world. Global stuff, right between Slovenia and Costa Rica, I think. Maternal mortality, birth weights, longevity, all of these things, I put them in and rate the country. As I recall, I think that France was number one in terms of distribution, in terms of availability of support system. I just came back from lecturing for 3 weeks in Australia. I love Australia. And they're ahead of us socially. They're so far ahead of us. It's much more socialistic. It's much more sharing. And you know, the Gini index, G-I-N-I, Gini index is the disparity between the richest and the poorest. America's second worst in the world. I think Yemen or someplace is worse than we. But how the hell can we have a equal healthcare system when we've got this kind of a disparity? So we need to work on that.
I'm curious what you think about what the future holds for Medicare. It's teetering on the brink. It's worked for a lot of people, and there's some pretty intense discussions right now about how to fix it. Do you have any thoughts on that?
Well, every projection has us going bankrupt from Medicare, particularly if you keep pouring billions of dollars down a black hole. You can't do that if you're not getting value for it. So what is the value? What should medicine do? In my book, I'm very proud of this part of my book, I define the mission of medicine. What's the mission of medicine? I proclaim that the mission of medicine is the assertion and assurance of the human potential. If that's the job of my profession, the assertion, knowing what we're capable of, and assuring that we get there. I like that. So is American medicine assuring the human potential? Are we getting to be 95 and 100 and running marathons? Are we band-aiding you and encouraging you to be sick and encouraging your dependency? So we need to get to a whole different, that's silent spring for health. That's what I'm hoping for.
Dr. Bortz, your book is dedicated to the renaissance of your profession. Do you have hope for that, and what would you advise young doctors today?
Well, we have a young doctor's son, and I'm, despite all my apparent cynicism up here, I think medicine is the greatest profession because we get out of bed in the morning and do good. And so we have to take the profit out of that. So fee-for-service medicine is a demon. If I get paid by how much I do, do you know one of the major things we learn in medical school is the operation known as a wallet biopsy? We frisk you and see where your wallet is, and then we stick a needle in that because that's where the money is. But what we need to do is get fee-for-service medicine out of the contract. We need the Chinese theory of paying on the 1st of January, and then you're on the same. I don't want to be paid the more you bleed. I want to help you not to bleed, and I want to help you understand that. So we're playing by the same, so then as we can make that a health system rather than a disease system.
Well, some of your ideas, for example, we've talked about a little bit about misaligned incentives and that doctors are being paid for a sick healthcare system, not a healthy one. And there's been a lot of talk about things like paying doctors for keeping people healthy, but they haven't really caught on. Can you talk a little about what we can do to turn that corner and and make the system healthier and not lose the good doctors who expect to make a decent living in this profession.
I've just finished a term on the Stanford Medical School Admissions Committee, and that's a hell of a job. We get 6,000 applicants. We interview 400 and accept 80. And everyone that's in there is a Nobel Prize winner. I mean, they're just so smart. But I love to think that they start out idealistic. And they get seduced and bushwhacked by all of their mentors. The whole Stanford faculty has a company. So they seduce these students into their labs, and it's very glorifying because it's where the glamour is. But we need to mature. We are still a very young profession. We are the youngest profession. Lewis Thomas wrote a book, Medicine, the Youngest Science. Mathematics and astronomy and chemistry and physics and biology, they have a pedigree. Medicine only started 150 years ago. So we're very young. So I excuse a lot of our foibles on the fact we have not matured. As when medicine can move into its maturity, which is to serve humanity, the common health, and we're teachers, I think we shall get away from our health illiteracy, and that's my final goal.
It's interesting because there's a passage, I think it's fairly early on in your book, in which you describe the treatments poor King Charles endured at the hands of his doctors in 1685. It involved, I think, at least bloodletting, more than a pint of blood, and a lot of other very uncomfortable sounding things. Some people, you wrote, said he met a far crueler fate than he would have at the hands of an executioner. So do you think we've come a far way from that in this young profession or not?
Well, I like to think that we've come a little ways. You know, we killed George Washington. Do you know that? He came in from a ride with a sore throat, and his doctors lay him down and took 6 or 8 pints of blood out in George. So we've come a ways since then. And last night I was watching a film that was made by a friend of ours, Ron Maxwell, on Gettysburg. And I have in my book some references to Civil War medicine. Well, Civil War was just yesterday. And the numbers of amputations in the Civil War were just gruesome because we didn't have any antibiotics. Legs were all gangrenous, but we did have anesthesia. So we're getting better incrementally. And I have a friend at the NIH who thinks he's got Alzheimer's here. Now that's gonna be 6 Nobel Prizes. We're trying to keep it out of the commercial realm right now. But if we can just turn a few more corners and just imagine getting up in the morning and having no Alzheimer's and no Parkinson's to worry about. Not a pill, but a nutrichemical. Hopeful. So we're getting better. We're gonna all of us make 100.
One reader asked, actually audience member says that now that the great Jack LaLanne has passed at 95 or 96, who will be the next role model? Can we count on you, Dr. Bortz?
Well, that's a cute thing, but it is kind of a personal thing. I have groupies that think as I do. And once I was given the opportunity to be a case study for a bunch of kids back at Virginia. And I was, Dr. Bortz, what are you going to do with this stuff? Because it's really good stuff. And the answer was, I have to be a rock star. I said, no way. I can't do that. That's not who I am. That's different. So we're going to need people. We think that old exercisers are important. People who can do things as they're old. What is the, I'm writing another book right now, is what's good about old? And Cicero wrote a book called De Senectute 2,500 years ago, in which he extolled the goodness. Now, one of the benefits of aging is wisdom. Now, you don't put a number on wisdom, but wisdom comes with age because it's the incremental accumulation of defeats. You don't learn by winning. learn about stubbing your toe. And each stub of the toe makes you a little smarter, a little wisdom. So here I am at 81, having more wisdom in my quiver than I did when I was 51 and 31. So there are advantages of being old. So I'm an apologist. The AARP bulletin this week had a story of, what's her name? Somebody who has how terrible it is to get old. All these people with Alzheimer's and depression. Oh, it's awful to get old. I'm the other side. I wrote a chapter in something called Aging as a Self-Fulfilling Prophecy. If you say you're going to be withered and painful and purple and impotent and a burden, that's the way it's going. On the other hand, you say, I'm going to be climbing trees. I'm going to be going to symphony. I will be leading a chorus. Then that gives the opportunity. And I think the science is on my side. Because your cells don't wear out. Your replication keeps going until it gets overwhelmed by the cascade of free radicals. Yes, there is the second law. It's real. So I'm not denying aging, but it's got a great codicil that it's improvable almost. Bortz's law is it's never too late to start, but it's always too soon to stop.
Dr. Bortz, unfortunately, we've reached the point in the program where there's very little time left, maybe a minute or two, and just wanted to offer you a moment to any last-minute tips to live a longer, healthy life that you didn't mention in our talk.
Well, just again to reiterate my thanks to the Commonwealth Club and for you folks being here. I think we're very lucky. What better place is there in the world than where we are? And the Commonwealth Club is part of that. I mean, we're all part of the community. And if you will all join me into being part of the common health, then we'll really be way ahead of the curve. Thank you for your attention.
Our thanks to Dr. Bortz, author of Next Medicine, The Science and Civics of Health. We also like to thank our audience here and on the radio. Tonight's program is presented in partnership with the Commonwealth Club's Grown Ups Forum. I'm Victoria Colliver, reporter with the San Francisco Chronicle. And now, this meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, the place where you're in the know, is adjourned. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Madam Moderator.